Welcome back to Tamano Perspective. With me now is Dual Secretary Rosalinda Baldos. Thank you, ma'am, for taking the time to come here.
Thank you also.
Actually, we're very honored. You've been with the department for 36 years.
Yes, 36 long, long years, and still enjoying my job.
Oh, that's wonderful. But I'm sure you're not enjoying what's happening to the laborers coming from Syria. How many have come back? What are the numbers since the Syrian problem happened?
Syria is a different market. Almost all our workers there are domestic helpers. That's one sad fact.
All right.
And almost 90% are undocumented. Only 10% are legally documented with the government.
Okay, so let's do some numbers.
You said we have 10, yet. Yes.
10% is documented.
Yes.
How many is that 10%?
We have around 3,000.
So which 3, means there are about 30,000 who are undocumented. And of these, let's say 30,000, how many have come back?
We have yet to receive the first returning OFW from Libya. And the reason is...
No, from Syria.
From Syria. There are 500, according to our labor attaché, who have registered. Meaning this is voluntary repatriation and they have to register. And they are still negotiating for their employers to release them because of the unserved portion of the contract.
Yeah, and, but isn't that so unreasonable?
Very unreasonable. Very unreasonable.
Your people are killing themselves already.
Yes, there is ongoing crisis.
Yet, why can't we just take them out if they want to go home?
No, they have to be issued an exit clearance for immigration purposes. They cannot just leave without a clearance from the employer. And so what our people there is doing, the embassy and the labor office, is they negotiate with the employer on the unserved portion, and if they need to pay, government money is being provided just to be able to release them from the employers and be given the exit clearance for purposes of immigration.
I mean, that's all well and good. It's good to hear that our government is even spending its own money to get our people out. But why don't we just get them out without that exit clearance? I'm sure if it was a U.S. national, they would take them out, even if their employer would refuse to give them an exit clearance.
I wouldn't know if that is really the case. What I know is that for everybody, there got to be an exit clearance. Maybe for other nationals, it's easy to get the clearance, but everybody gets a clearance.
All right, how about in Libya? How many people have
Libya
come back so far?
Libya is 2,200 something. We just received the latest yesterday, 37 of them.
And about how many Filipino workers,
I think less than 2,000 over there.
Okay.
And all of them are documented.
Okay, so you have about 3,000 people coming back.
Yes.
What are they going to do here?
Well, it all depends. For domestic helpers, I think their salaries there would be the range of $150 to $200, despite our set minimum wage of $400.
Hey, that is surprising. That's,
yes.
So you're talking about 8,000,
yes,
10,000
yes,
pesos?
Yes, yes, yes. And you would imagine, you know, the social cost that cannot be quantified.
That's right.
Or you cannot put peso sign in it. And most of them are women.
All right.
So imagine, especially if they are the mother, the mother of the family. So you could just imagine the social cost that would go when the mother is out.
Yes.
But the thing is that when they come back, since they don't really have the skills to be employed locally or even for us to entice them to go back again without undergoing upskilling.
So when you talk about upskilling, that means giving them more skills,
more
right?
More skills.
So what do
and
they
not
do?
Land in another DH job.
Yeah, so they come back here, do they have opportunities
here?
Yeah,
the immediate assistance that the government is able to give them is to have immediate source of livelihood.
All right.
So you mentioned here in your program the starter kit.
Yes.
Now some of them would want to go immediately into some sort of cosmetology, doing hairstyling, and we immediately enroll them in a test training skills for that. And after they finish the training, we give that grant. It's not a loan. And instead of giving them the cash, we purchase all the necessary tools that they need for
their things. So, for example, you'll buy them manicure
set, everything, spas, the set, things like that. If they want to engage in meat processing or any food processing, we buy them the equipment.
But and what's the process? Because I'm trying to put myself in their shoes. So they come back, you know, since they're domestic, they don't have jobs, and they're not exactly the best educated.
Yes.
So do they know that these programs exist? And how do they apply for these programs?
Yes, they know that there is a Balik Pinay, Balik Hanap Buhay for them, especially for the domestic helpers. So once they enroll, because we meet them at the airport, we process them, we profile them, and then they would indicate to us what is it that the immediate interest to get a job that would earn them something. And so if they say, I want to do hairstyling, or I want to be a physical therapist, the one that would do massage, then part of the package of that starter kit would be the skills training necessary.
And who provides that?
That is TESDA's partnership with us. TESDA is under Dole, and TESDA, once they get a referral from us, then they give the skills training free of charge.
But how does that work? I mean, it all sounds very good, but I'm trying to imagine on a practical experience
at the regional office.
Like they go to the office.
At the regional office, then you have the service provider that enable us to immediately bring them to a training center accredited by TESDA. And since this is not a really intensive skills training, it's not so long, then immediately we have to prepare for the necessary tools and equipment for them to practice already the skills.
And then how long does the process take? How long does the training and the upskilling, how long does that take
place? I think from 2 to 3 weeks.
So like in a month. And then they'll go out and try to ply their trade.
Yes,
Now my worry is two things. First, what if they fail? What happens next? Let's say, you know, they try to sell meat products or do cosmetology, but nobody gets them. How do they pay off that 10,000?
No, they don't pay. It's a grant. It's a grant. Really to tie them up so that in the meantime that they don't have immediate source of income, then, as I said, they are provided with some alternative employment and source of livelihood. But the thing is that we give them enough time. There is business counseling that first go, and then they finally decide that in our community, this is where I can immediately earn something, and therefore I need to acquire the skills for this. They are enrolled in a skills training program. And as I said, we provided everything, including the initial cost of the materials that they need so that they can really start
up. That seems like a very positive program. Now let's bring this to a more macro scale. What are the numbers that we're talking about when we talk about unemployment rates now in the Philippines?
Unemployment rate would be 7.3%.
Is that a high or a low rate?
It's almost the same for the last 10 years. It is not really significantly changed. So the employment rate would be 92.7%.
The reason I ask that is because we will have more and more OFWs coming back.
Yes.
Not just because of the Arab experience, but also with the slowdown in the economies in the US and Europe.
Okay.
As Secretary of Labor, what are your thoughts on can we absorb these people into our economy?
We need more investments.
All right.
We need to target the growth that our economy is projected to produce, and that is 7 to 8%. And the employment projection based on that growth would be an average annually of 1 million jobs.
On your side, on the Department of Labor side, what have you been doing? Because this is projected. This is going to happen.
Can you
please, as a final word, what specific programs are you doing to address this influx, perhaps a deluge of OFWs coming back to our country looking for jobs?
We have electronic jobs and skills matching facilities. So this is the PhilJobNet. our employers would lag their vacancies, our job applicants would also lag all the profiles for them to be able to land a job. And therefore, at any given point in time, around 60,000 to 100,000 jobs would be available in the net. And of course, they would have to do some matching with the employer. In other words, we just provide the facility so that they can access the job vacancies, but the matter of qualifying is for them to do so before their employers who are interested to hire them.
How about the entrepreneurial side?
The entrepreneurial is, other than the starter kit for micro entrepreneurs, the president has asked OWA to set aside 1 billion reintegration fund that was doubled by Land Bank and DBP, and from 300,000 to 2 million, they can access for those who are really interested in
becoming entrepreneurs.
Oh, and Land Bank is the one handling, you know, all the technical evaluation.
Well, that's very good to hear. Secretary Baldos, thank you so much for joining us. Stay tuned for more Tamano Perspective.